Here you don't have to do anything because in Colab everything has been installed, right? You need to install either the Miniconda or Anaconda. Miniconda will be fine. You install Miniconda or Anaconda package, whether it is Windows or Ubuntu, you can get it, right? So once you get it, so you go inside that and you install Conda space, you know, install Python, right? What all things you need to install, right? Python 3. Then you need NumPy. What all packages you need, you can install it. Like Pandas, we'll be talking about Pandas now. Matplotlib, so and so, Jupyter Notebook. Now, you want to ask me something, you can ask. In Google Meet, there is not much problem actually. Even if you talk in between, does not create any issue. Yeah. You want to ask me some doubt or I don't know. So here, this is one way. Otherwise, you need to install Python. You need to install Python installer, something like pip is there, right? PIP. So once you install Python, you need to install pip for Python 3. That is pip 3. And using pip 3, you can install all these things. That is pip 3 space install your packages like the NumPy, Pandas, and so, Matplotlib, Jupyter Notebook. Now, so this is a command for importing NumPy package, and you can see that I have used AS, a word called AS, right? And I have given a name called NP. You can give any name. It is not mandatory that you should give NP, right? So this means that you are giving alias. Alias or alternate name. Okay, so NP is going to be the alternate name for NumPy, right? This is a standard kind of convention. That's the reason that we use this NP everywhere. Whenever you see Python code, you'll be seeing this NumPy as NP, because most of the follow this convention. Most of the people follow this convention, and you can have any name as per your wish. If you want to install it in your name or my name, let's say NumPy as Ravi, you can do that, right? There is no issue. That's only an alias. The beauty of ID is that when you type this, suggestion will automatically come. Like, you don't have to do this. So execute that cell. So executing this cell is extremely important. Then only you will be able to use all the functions present inside. Okay. So we will start with a concept called array. So array means elements with homogeneous type, right? Isn't it? Collection of elements having same data type. That's why you define array, right? So let us have an array here. So how will you define an array? Using NumPy only you need to define, right? So np dot, when you put that a itself, you can see the suggestions coming up, right? When you put that arr, you can see that it's already there for you, right? Now inside that you put a parenthesis, right? Inside that you pass a list, right? So let's say 13 always will be there. It is my favorite number, right? So 17 minus 21 minus 13. So this is going to be my array. Okay, this is how you define an array in this NumPy, right? This is how you define things. Using NumPy, you have defined an array, right? So now you want to check whether don't believe what I say, right? You should check whether it is the type of exist, type of exist array or not. You want to ask me something, sir? Oh, okay. So you want to type, you want to check the type of this, then only you believe, right? So you put type of x, let's see what will happen. It will be numpy dot n dimensional array, nd array. So this will be the type, hope you understood, right? This indicates that this is an array. Similarly, you can define, you know, two dimensional arrays, but now you can see only, consider only one dimension, right? You can define two dimensional array, right? You can even go for that. Let us define a two dimensional array. Let's say x underscore 2d is equal to np dot array. Let's say 13, 24, right? That should come in the first row. So let me put it inside a bracket. And next one, next row, let us say 89 and 76. So you could see this one in the first row and this one in the second row. Okay? Yeah. How will you visualize this? How will you visualize this? Let us visualize this. Now, let me create a new Jamboard. You can see the element which I have defined, the 13, 24, 89 and 76, right? So 13 and 24, it will come in the first row, right? I don't have a writing pen, I am writing with the touchpad only. So it would have been more beautiful if I had a stylus or something. You can see this is how you visualize that two dimensional array which we have defined now. So the first row consists of 13 and 24 and second row consists of 18 and 76. Hope you understood. So this is indicated by in Python by, you know, square bracket inside that, so that will show the first row and this second one. So comma also between elements, and that's it. Okay. Now, so we defined a number arrays and a single dimensional array, and we defined two dimensional array, right? Now, so let me define one more array. So let me define y is equal to np dot array. The 12, 14, 16, 8. So how many elements were there in x? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, right? 1, 2, 3, 4. One more element input us. Let's say 7. So y is another array, right? So I try to add this x and y. Okay, how will you do that? The beauty of this is that this array concept in NumPy is that you can add these two things by simply putting x plus y. So element wise addition will happen. Let's see. So you can print the reset to verify whether an addition has happened or not. Yes, you can see. See, add the corresponding elements of x and y. You can see 13 plus 12, it is going to be 25. That you can see it here. Similarly, you could see the remaining element. So, in case of list, it is not possible. Right? What happens if you are simply using plus operator in case of list? Will it be possible? Yes or no? Please reply in the chat window. Can you do the same thing with the help of a list? Let's say you are defining excess lists. Somebody asked me what is the advantage of using arrays yesterday. Right? I told you that wait, we'll be discussing everything, right? Please wait. So let's say we have a two lists, x and y. Let's say y underscore list is equal to 13, 67, 89, and 90. Now you have two lists, right? Now let me do the same thing which I have done there. So let me put x underscore list plus y underscore list. Come on, tell me what will be the output here. Make a guess. What will be the output? Make a guess. Exactly, concatenation. Very good. Right? Yeah, it will be merged. Two lists will be merged. You can see that. Why? Because this plus will act as plus will see that the operand type of the whatever present here, x underscore list, the type of this operand is going to be list, and type of this operand is also going to be list. So plus will simply concatenate it, or rather merge it, and you can see the output here. But you can do the same thing with the list. How will you do that? That's my next question. The same addition you can do with the help of list. How will you do? My question is, addition using list, addition on list element, not using on list, how will you perform? Convert list into numpy array. Yeah, that is that we already discussed. Numpy has got that advantage. Imagine that that concept is not there. Numpy array is not there for you. How will you do that? Imagine that I did not tell you the concept of numpy arrays. So how will you add this? Indexing. Loop, exactly, right? You need to use loop. But you know that using loop is not at all efficient. It takes time, isn't it? Right? That's the reason why we say that array, numpy arrays are efficient. Yesterday somebody asked me why array is said to be efficient. This is the answer for that. I told to wait. I will be discussing everything. I told you to please give me time only, right? I wanted to discuss everything very well rather than going in a hurry burry, right? Hope you understood. Have you all understood this much? We talked about one dimensional array and two dimensional array. We need to advance further. So before that, I'm just checking whether it's okay for all of you. Yeah, thanks for the wonderful responses. Yeah, this is beautiful. Why? Because I could see all the names, whereas in WebEx, I could see only, suppose for example, if Miss Anita Karthikeyan is typing in WebEx, I could see AK. I can't even predict the gender who is AK, right? And also, suppose Anand Sawale, if Mr. Anand Sawale is typing, I could see in WebEx, AS. That's a problem. Even people with, even two characters, if you have, yeah, Shaina Shashi, for example, it will show as 2S in WebEx, right? Yeah, great to see the response. Now, we move forward to next topic, that is, if you want to see the shape of that array, right? You want to see the shape of the numpy array. how will you do that? See, you have got a lot of methods available. You can make use of that, right? So let's say x, we already defined that x is a numpy array. You want to see the shape of that. What do you do? You click on that. See, listen here. Listen. You can see the one search sorted here in the below. This is going to be a method. You already mentioned what a method is, right? You can call a method using the object. Here you have a numpy object, right? But the one above, you can see that shape. That is not going to be a method. You could see that. The symbol itself, yeah, it is going to be an attribute, or you can say a data member, right? It is not a method. You should not use a parenthesis. Okay, should not use a parenthesis. It's not a method. You will see the shape of it. What it indicates? You have five rows and one column, right? So that is what your x is all about, right? You could see that. You have five. You could see that the shape is going to be five elements, right? 1, 2, 3, 4, five elements and one row, right? Y comma y, one indicates five elements, and you have got. Now let's see the shape of x underscore 2d. Two elements. Yeah, you could see that two rows and two columns are there, right? You can see that two rows and two columns. Okay. Hope you understood. Yeah. What is the meaning of how to print in table format? I do not understand. Table form. Yeah, you need to go through for loop, and printing means you need to do that. That's only. Please share the code in the chat. Yeah, it's already shared. The file is already shared. You can access it from anywhere. It's already shared. Somebody please copy that link again. Paste the link again so that it's already shared. So you might have joined late. Sorry. Yeah, it's already there. You could see that. Now, so let's move forward to the next concept. That is, you can perform operations like Boolean operations, which you have when conditional operators you can perform on this, right? So how will you do that? Suppose you want to compare x and y, right? You want to compare x and y. Let's say you need to compare x and y, right? What will be out? You can see that element wise comparison will happen, and you can see, yeah, first value is true. That means that you examine your x and y. What is your x and what is your y? Yeah, your x is going to be 13. And your y is 12, 13 greater than 12. Is that true? Yes, right? You are not audible. Am I not audible? To others, I'm asking. Am I not audible? Yeah, I think you please check your network connection. I am pretty much confident with my network connection. I told you that I am residing in a city where 4G is available with full range, and I have been taking with this same connection for classes using the same connection for months. I did not experience any kind of issue, but I am that much damn confident about that. Now, and I'm using mobile data also only for this purpose, for this audio purpose only. The screen, you can see it is connected to some other Wi-Fi available here, because screen is not important. If screen goes, I can verify to my screen, a mobile phone. So I can straight away, I can change the connection, right? You can see that it's connected to broadband, right? No. I think I told the same thing in the morning also. Please don't misunderstand my network connection. So it is perfect. So now, again, you compare 15 and 14. 15 is greater than 14, right? So that's the reason why you got a true there. So element-wise comparison is happened. You got a true there, you got a true here, and the remaining elements you got false. Why? Because it might have been lesser. So now we can check for this less than, right? It is extremely important, especially when it comes to data manipulation using pandas. This operator is very, very good, right? It helps us in a lot of things. Easily you can do, especially when you call it as indexing, when you want to apply in your data frame. So this helps for indexing very easily. Okay. Addition of array, how negative number? I don't understand. So you can add negative numbers also. That's available here. You already add minus 13, you could see here, right? So minus 13 and you had 5 plus 7. What is the answer going to be? Minus 6. You already got that, right? What is the problem? Yeah. Now we talk about something else. We talk about finding out the mean value, right? Mean is what? Average value, right? Isn't it? So we are going to find out the mean value, x. How do you find out that? You have some x. I told you a lot of methods are available. See that. You can distinguish between methods and the data members or attributes, right? You can see methods, it's like a square, you know, a cube, you can see, right? You can see a cube symbol, whereas this is not a perfect cube. The length of sides are different, right? You can call it as a cuboid or something, right? Shape, size and all those things, right? But whereas sort, squeeze, std, these are all cubes. So those represent methods, right? So here you have the method to find out mean. You can see that when I type x dot mean, you can see mean will be available, right? So let us move down. Yeah, the mean is available. This is going to be 2.2, the average value. Hope you understood, right? Similarly, we can go for median. What is the difference between median and mean? Mean is going to be your average value. Median is going to be, suppose you have values like this. What will be your median? Let us put this as r is equal to x less than b, right? Going to be r is going to be an array. So I need to find out that. Let me print that r first. What will be the median here? Come on, make a guess. What will be the median here? In this r, what is the median? Yeah, three of you have replied, it's going to be false. Yeah. All of you are replying. Any other contradiction? No, right? So median is going to be your middle value, right? It is going to be this middle value. And you will have one doubt here. When you have even number of values there, how will you find out the median? So when you have even number of values, you need to take the average of the middle values. That will be your median. Okay. Yeah, you cannot have that median method available inside NumPy. You could see that it throws an error, right? Median is not available, but standard deviation is available. Yeah, you can see that standard deviation, you can find out. It's going to be the standard deviation. Yeah. So now we go to another thing, another concept. We just go to visualization. We'll come back to NumPy. Why? Because when you discuss about pandas, all the features of the NumPy will you be using. Why? Because pandas is built on top of NumPy, so it can make use of all the functionalities of this NumPy. We talk about plus only, you can even perform multiplication, you can even perform element wise and a multiplication, a lot of operations are possible. We'll be doing all those things when we discuss about pandas. Okay, so pandas is built on top of NumPy. That means it can use all the capabilities of NumPy. Now let me go to data visualization now. And if you want to see much more things on NumPy, there is a official documentation page for NumPy. You can refer to that. And NumPy has got a Linalge module. Linalge means linear algebra module. Using that, you can even perform inverse operation, transpose, or whatever operation you want. Right? There is a module called Linalge available in NumPy. You can make use of that. So this is going to be the NumPy documentation. So we can search, right? We can find it out so that all the if you want to see much about Linalge, you type Linalge there. Yeah, you can see the linear algebra module. You can see. Click on that. Why we use NumPy, not directly Pandas? Yeah, I just wanted to mention some basics, right? NumPy also, it is Pandas is using the capabilities of NumPy, right? So that array concept I wanted to mention you, right? So that's why I have talked about NumPy, right? Python does not have that array data structure, right? That is incorporated with the help of NumPy package. Yeah, this is a Linalge module inside NumPy. So inside NumPy, so you can see the NumPy.linalge. So NP.linalge, you have to call it, right? So inside that, you can see what all kind of operations you can perform. What of operations? While developing a machine learning algorithm, you require all those things. Especially in things like eigenvalues, all those things are extremely important. Especially when you talk about orthogonalization and all those things. And I tell you, a lot of math is involved behind that. And this module will help you to perform a lot of linear algebra related. Linear algebra is a must prerequisite for learning machine learning, right? This module, Linalge, will help you to understand much more things, right? So always refer the documentation page, official documentation page. For syntax or anything, because you want to. So this is the dot product. We mentioned dot product in the morning session, right? Theta transpose dot x, isn't it? So that dot product you are finding out. Click on this dot, you will see the details of the dot product. How will you find out? A and B are two arrays, so it will find out the dot product of two arrays. You also called as vector, right? We seen that theta transpose into x, where theta transpose is a vector and x is another vector. How to calculate entropy value using function in Python? Yeah, you might be talking about that entropy which you have learned in decision tree, right? You need to apply formula, right? Then only you can find it out. I don't know whether direct function is available. We need to explore that. Yeah, you might be asking about ID3 algorithm, where you have learned entropy, right? Yeah. We need to use that formula. We need to implement that. Otherwise, you can. I don't know whether the function is available default or not. Right? So let me go to data visualization, right? So we will talk about Matplotlib, and if possible, if there is time, I will talk about another wonderful library which is built on top of Matplotlib called Seaborn, right? And why do we need data visualization? That's my question. Why do we need this? To better understand data, right? They say that a picture speaks 1,000 words than, you know, an essay or whatever you write. Always, it's always better to incorporate figures. To better understand what I said, what I typed there, better understand, right? Better understand. This happens. We are doing multitasking, right? That is not at all possible for men, even though it is easy for females, right? So to better understand data, you require this visualization, right? Or rather, you can say to get meaningful insights from the data. Okay. The package which is useful for performing this, you called as Matplotlib, right? And again, inside Matplotlib, you can see the suggestion here. Inside Matplotlib, you have a sub package called Pyplot. In MATLAB, you can. Yeah, I don't know. I need to explore that. I told you. I'll explore it and I'll tell you whether that function is there or not. You can simply search in Google, or you can find out whether it's there. I'll do it towards end of session. Please wait. Yeah, I one thing I tell you, nobody can be perfect, and whatever functions you know, I may not be knowing that. Right? So if you ask whatever things you know, it will be difficult for anybody to explain. Not only me, even people with years of experience may also find. If you ask. Something which is related to what I have mentioned, you can ask. Still, if I don't know, you will search it out and find out. So you ask me about entropy, maybe there in function, maybe there, not in Python, but it may be incorporated in some other packages like SciPy. There is a package called SciPy, or it is available in NumPy. In any of these packages, it might be there. Okay, we need to find it out. Nobody can by heart all this kind of methods and come and have a session. Right? That is not at all a way also. So everything is available, functions available for you. You need to use it according to your purpose. So this is how you import your Pyplot sub-package. I told you Pyplot is a sub-package. And the normal alias I use for this is ELT, right? So you execute that. Why I tell you to execute? Why? Because then only you will be able to use the function inside this PLT. If you don't execute, it won't show the suggestion. Okay. So it is must that you should execute. Now, what we are going to do is let us have a list called height, right? So come on. Let us have your heights one by one, right? Let's say five people, you type your heights there. I hope it won't be a personal kind of, if you feel that it's too much personal, don't type there. Yeah, let's say 149, right? Then 170, yeah. And 164, or rather 159, 164. 159 and 164, right? And finally, let me have my own height. Yeah, I got another 1752 already. Yeah, fine. Five values I got, right? So, let us have weight also. Now, you people will not be, will be hesitant to type, right? Your weight. I don't know whether you will be okay to type weight also, right? So, this height should be in centimeter and weight. Yeah, somebody, I think I got values also for that, right? So, 60, then 78, then I hope it is the correct weight, right? Yeah, 65. One more, we can have 72. Yeah, fine. So you got height and weight, two lists, right? We got five elements in each. Yeah. Now we have six elements there at the top, so we should incorporate one more. Yeah, let's have 82 also. Yeah. So what we are trying to do is we are going to have a visualization using this data, right? So for that, you need to use PLT. Right, dot, you have a lot of functions available for, let us have a line plot now, line plot. So for plotting a line plot, right, you need to use that function called plot. You set plot. And inside that, you pass on your two list, height and, what was it? Height and, comma, height, comma, that is going to be your X. And next one is going to be your weight. Okay? And understand that the star arcs here indicates that you have positional arguments, right? Star here indicates you can have any number of positional arguments. Any number, that is the meaning of a star here. It is not does not have any relation with the pointer concept you have learned in C, right? Whenever you say star, people get afraid. You know what is the star? Hell of the star is here also, right? In Python also. So that is creating trouble in C. But it's here in Python also, though. No, this is different. This star arcs, the arcs is nothing, arguments, right? So this indicates a positional arguments, right? Positional arguments means you cannot the order is important here. You cannot change the order, but you can give any number of arguments. And you can see something else, double star KWRs, right? Which is going to be keyword. Somebody said that height and weight are not equal. Let me check that. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, yeah. 5 only. It is not equal. Yeah. Thanks for noting it. Now, I was talking about what? Yeah, arcs and KWRs, right? So, KWRs means it is going to be keyword arcs. Okay? So, keyword arcs means, yeah, you can see that keyword arguments. Keyword argument means something like X is equal to Y is equal to, you put a key value pair, just like what you put in inside dictionary, right? So we'll be learning about keyword arguments. So there is no position in that case. You can mix up the position. You can give Y is equal to first and X is equal to second, right? So those arguments you called as keyword arguments. That means you specify the keyword also. For example, X is equal to 1.8. Y is equal to, like that, key value. So key is your X and value is your 1.8. So those you call it as keyword arguments. So I have attended a lot of trainings for the past 2 to 3 years. Nobody taught me what are these things really, right? So since I referred many materials, I could understand what are these star arguments and double star keyword arguments. That means you can have n number of arguments. These are going to be your positional arguments, and these are going to be keyword arguments. Arguments, you know, right? Whatever you supply to the function, you call it as argument. Here, height and weight, both you call it as argument. Okay. So let us have this plot. So what it does is it creates a line plot for you. Creates a line plot. Yeah. What happened here is, dimension. What you said is incorrect only. Here 1 2 3 4 5 1 2 3 4 5, you have 5 dimensions each, right? So then what happened? I did not execute that. Once you make the change, remember, execute that cell, right? Otherwise it will show error. You can see that line plot, right? Ugly looking kind of line plot. Why? Because due to our data. See, our data is a kind of, for 60 comes in the x-axis, right? And height comes in the x-axis and weight comes in the y-axis, right? So you can give in the reverse manner. Let's say weight should be in the x-axis and height in the y-axis. Let's see what happens, right? Yeah, you can see something like this, right? So weight, you can see 445. What is going to be the height? Is going to be 45. There is no value like that, right? Even 42. Yeah, for 42, the value is going to be 159. You can see that. For 42, the value is going to be 159. This is going to be one data point, right? And this is not, this is not a better plot for this data, right? You understand this is not a better plot for this data, right? So what you can go for some other kind of data, but still I want to mention you how to give you X label and Y label. It's very easy. You again put a PLT dot. You can put a X label so that it will come X label, right? You can give any name, a string value, right? So what is our X here? It is going to be weight. Okay. So similarly, you can put Y label. So PLT dot. You put PLT dot Y label, and inside that you can type height. Fine. Okay, and you can give it title also, right? Title again, PLT dot, you have something called title available, so it uses, right? So title means can be something called BMI, whatever it is, right? Height versus weight, you called as body mass index or kind of thing, right? Whatever it is, or rather you can put it as weight versus height, okay? And finally, see, in Jupyter notebook, it will show the output even though you don't use this command. But it is must when you type in your file to use this plt.show. Otherwise, it will not show anything, right? Show your figure. So it is must that you should use this, right? In Jupyter notebook, it will work even if you don't give that. Okay? So let us execute that. Yeah, now we can see that label or title for x-axis, you can see weight coming here, right? And height on the y-axis, and again you can see the title comes weight versus height at the top, right? So it's simple. You need to give x label, y label and title, right? And finally you have to show it, so it will come. Now this plot does not look better to me, so I can change it, right? The same thing, I am copying the entire thing. I will make very few modifications only. So what I am going to make change here is, I will have some other kind of plot called scatter plot. Okay, so I believe that scatter plot is will be fine for this rather than line plot. Okay, so that I can understand something. Sorry, I told you due to some just the congestion problems, I have a little bit irritability, especially since today afternoon. So now, due to some dust allergy or kind of thing, so that way it happens. So we need to have a scatter plot here. So to plot a scatter plot, we can have something called scatter here, right? Can you make use of the scatter so that we will be able to see? Yes, this looks fine, right? Okay, so you can see data points at each places, right? Okay. So imagine that you have a lot of data points. So from that, you can understand some kind of relationship between your attributes, whether it is linear or not, when you plot it like this. Since you have only very few data points, you cannot say that it is linear, but if you exclude these two outliers, you can fit a line to this. You can fit a line to this, and you can find out the difference between them, right? Somebody wanted to ask me something. Can you show the scatter plot? Yeah, I have copied the same thing. So what I have done is replace a plot with the scatter. That's the only difference I have made. Okay. Is that fine? And the file is already shared also. Could you please paste the link again, some of you? You have been doing that. No. It is available at the top in the chat window. Somebody please help in pasting that link again. That's there. You can see that link. Thank you. Thank you so much, Mr. Anil. Really, now we could actually have a network, in this Google Meet. It's perfect platform, I tell you. I enjoy this rather than the other kind of platform. Yeah. Now we talk about a wonderful, wonderful concept called histogram. Right? Histogram. So what it gives histogram? Histogram gives you data distribution. Right? It gives you data distribution. Let us define the histogram first using the Jamboard, then we will try to code it. Okay, so let us have a system done. Suppose you have a set of values like x is equal to, let's say, 13, then 13.5. Then 16, right? Then let's say some middle values, 46, 48, two values, right? 46, 48. And you have some values at the 111, 121. So two values at that extreme range, right? It's going to be 13.5. So I am going to draw a histogram of this. How will you draw that? I'm going to draw a histogram. So you take that, you have only one data, right? X-axis, you have only one data. So this in y-axis, what happens is in y-axis we'll be getting the data distribution, right? We'll be getting the distribution, or rather you can say how many data, how many. For example, you say that between 13 to 16, right? This is a range between, use another color. So let's say this is a range, 13 to 16, you called as an interval, you again called as a bin. So how many data points are there? Three are there, right? So let's say this is 1, 2, 3. So that means you have a data, you have the distribution, you have a bar, or you can say this, at times it is difficult to draw. Yeah, you have the bar indicating this, that. You have got three data points. What are the data points? 13, 13.5 and 16. So you are dividing your x-axis equal into equal intervals. Dividing your x-axis into equal intervals. Again, in between 46 to 48, you can say two values. Right? And let's say, 111, 121, you have again two values, right? In between you have a lot of bins. Let's say this is one bin. In between you have two bins, but it is invisible. Why? Because there is no data, right? So in effect, you have divided your x-axis into equal number of, now let's say how many bins are there? 1, 2, 3, 4, right? 5. Many people don't know the concept behind this histogram pretty well. 7 bins you have. You can change this to 10 bins or 5 bins or whatever you want. Because these are, imagine that they are equal intervals. This interval, it is same. These intervals, right? Imagine that these are same. Width is same. Okay. So you are dividing that x-axis into equal intervals. X-axis you are dividing it into equal intervals. You call it as bins or baskets, and that will give you an idea about your data distribution, right? This is what histogram is all about. Now let's go back and try to plot the histogram of the data which we have seen, right? So let's say x is equal to 14.7, then you have, let's say, 56, then 59, let's say 111, 123, 124, like that, right? So we are trying to plot the histogram of this, right? So how will you do that? Again, you go, you use the PLT, the PLT dot, you put that hist, right? And inside that, yeah, what is your data? You need to mention the data x there. X you already defined that, right? Comma. What is your bins, right? By default it will take 10 bins, no issue. You can change that. Let's say I need to have 5 bins. Okay, I need to have 5 bins. And what is needed actually after this, you need to use that plt.show. Otherwise, it won't show the figure, especially when you are doing it in a file. It will show it here in Jupyter notebook, but it will not controller, which you can see that, right? The data distribution, you can see. What it indicates, yeah, in between this range, you can see how many data points, 3 data points. That might be the data points like 13, 13.6 and 14.7. But you can see 56 and 59, you can see it. 56, it's considered separately, 56, 59. You can see one each, right? One each. And finally, you have something like this. So if I remove that 56, it will be better. You can see that in between. Or I can even increase the number of bins. So let's say I have bins, we increase it to 10. So by default, it will be 10. So let me increase it. So now let's see what happens. Yeah, now we can see that you have one value here. You can see two merged together, two bins merged together here, right? So this is one bin, and this is another bin, and this is another bin, right? Hope you understood. Have you understood it? Yes or no? Have you understood? Are you able to follow? Please type yes or no. So this histogram is extremely useful for finding out the data distribution. Thanks for the wonderful response. Yeah. Now that, let me move forward. So we talk about we talked about many visualization frameworks. So we go to pandas now, right? We will come back. We'll come back and we talk about the remaining data visualization. We discuss about the pandas now. So then, using the pandas, we can again make use of this visualization. I tell you, pandas is built on top of Matplotlib and NumPy. Right, we are going to define, we are going to learn another package called pandas. You can use a text box. Pandas package, it is used for data manipulation, right? Okay, so this is built on top of Matplotlib and NumPy. So that means it can make use of that visualization capability of Matplotlib as well as the numerical computation capability of NumPy. That is the meaning of this when we say it is built on top of data manipulation. Yeah. So we see pandas now, right? Yeah. Yesterday, some of you asked me how to import a data into your Colab environment. It's very simple, right? You need to find out a data first, right? You need to find out a data. So we will go to whatever you said in the morning, right? You want to manipulate on COVID-19 data. Of course, we can do that, right? So let us download the data set. I will give you the link. Probably you can download it from there. You have a lot of sites available. So I tell you from where you need to download. People does data set. Yeah, probably this one, let me check which is better for you. Yeah, this might be good because I have already done some analysis of this. I will give you the link, don't worry. Let me examine. Yeah. It is not good. So let me go to this site. Yeah, here you can get it. Here, yes, download the complete COVID-19 data set. You can see that a CSV file is there. You try to download the CSV file. Okay, so let me give you this link so that you can download it. Not this one, so this one, right? You can download this. Let me put it in your chat box where you can download the same. Right. Go to the page, scroll down, you'll be able to see this. Otherwise, I'll give this link. wait. I will give this link directly. Where is it? Where is Google Meet? Yeah, I will give this link. The second link, you need to click on that, so you'll be able to download it. Second link is fine. No need to bother about the first one and download it. Yeah, you can get it from Kaggle also, but right now I'm working in this. So download the dataset. I hope all of you have downloaded the dataset, right? Now, I'll tell you one of the most important concept here, how to upload your dataset permanently in your Google Drive, right? And once you upload a dataset permanently on Google Drive, you can easily get the data from here, right? So what you can do here is, those who have done Colab notebook yesterday will be able to see this folder in your Google Drive. I think you will be able to see that, right? How many of you can see that folder? The yellow labeled, by default it will be yellow labeled one, this Colab notebook folder, this one. How many of you are able to see? Please type yes in the chat window, please. Great. Yeah, better we keep all our Colab notebook files there itself. You go inside that and then you open the thing, right? So here what I try to do is, here I try to create a new folder for data, let's say data for data sets. Sample data sets, right? So I just created a folder there inside that. So I just went inside that folder. Yeah, I just went inside this folder. Now, you can upload the data set which you have downloaded, right? So you click on the upload files. You know, right, how to upload a file into your Google Drive. Same thing. You upload the file. Yeah, what I said is, you go to your Colab notebooks. That's all. Nothing else. You go to your Colab. That Colab notebooks folder will be created for you in Google Drive by default. If you have done something on Colab, it will be created for you. So you go, just go to that. That's all, right? So I think that file is available. This is my brother-in-law's laptop. Yeah, it's available. You see that it is available. It has been uploaded. Okay, fine. Now, have you all completed this much this step? Yes or no? Those who have completed till this, please type yes there in the chat window. Yes, great. We should download the Colab notebook. So no need to download the Colab notebook. I told you, I think I have given you the link to download the data set. Once again, I'll copy the link there. So this is a link, right? For you, Mr. Revathi, this is a link. You click on that link so that you will be able to download the data, right? So once you download the data, you go to your Google Drive. And inside your Google Drive, you will be able to see this folder named Colab Notebooks. If you have already done something on that, this folder will be created by default. And inside your Colab Notebook, all your Colab files will be there. I told you to simply create a folder. You can do this in anywhere you wish, but I just wanted to have a uniqueness. That's why I told you to do this. So put it inside datasets and go inside datasets and no folder. I think you haven't done that's why, sir. If you have done that, it will be created. Miss Sakshi, it will be created if you have done something. Surely created. Yeah, if those who don't have a folder, you can create a folder in your My Drive, right? Google Drive. You can create a folder anywhere you want, right? Here, if you want to create a new folder, you click on new and create a folder in your name or dataset or whatever you need, right? It will be created once you finish a Colab notebook. It will be created for sure, I tell you. Because those people who have done, yeah, you could see the comment, chat comments there, right? For most of them, it has been created. Yeah. It will be created, don't worry, it will be there for you. Now, the most important thing, those who have done so far, you know, please listen carefully. Please don't ask me to repeat once again. What you can do here is click on that folder here, right? Yeah, you can see that nice way of mounting your Google Drive here. When you place your cursor on that symbol, you can see my cursor where it is. you can see that mount drive option. Click on that mount drive option, right? So that your Google Drive will be mounted. It will show permission. You need to give permission, connect to Google Drive. Yeah, you give permission, no problem, right? Whatever your data is, it's already with Google. So whatever you do, you play with your data, whether you put it inside Collab or whether you insert Gmail or wherever it is, it belongs to Google Drive. So they can manipulate whatever they want, right? Simply, I'm telling a joke. Don't worry. Yeah, then once you mount that, you will be seeing a kind of symbol like this. That means you need to unmount only, right? That option is only available. I've already mounted. So once you mount that, you will be able to see this folder drive. Are you able to see that? Yeah, you'll be able to see drive inside, go inside that drive. You can see your My Drive, right? Click again. You can navigate to your Google Drive, entire Google Drive contents. It will be available to you, right? And come on, just scroll down. You can see that Collab. Otherwise, you can put control of Collab there. Yeah, it's there, right? Collab notebooks. Go inside that, navigate to that, right? You click one. You need to click once only. No need of double click is needed. So again, scroll down a bit. Yeah, scroll down a bit. You can see the data sets there. Right click on that, copy that path. Right, what I have done, go inside dataset. Now you can see the .csv file. Yeah, you just copy that path, right click. Okay, here you have to right click on this and copy that path. Have you done this much? Copy the path. Yeah, you missed that. One second, I'll tell you. Have you mounted your Google Drive? Yes or no? Have you mounted your Google Drive, Miss Revathi? Have you mounted your? Yeah, for mounting your Google Drive, what you need to do is, see, you click on this folder icon here, left side, folder or other file icon. Here, you can see when you place your cursor here, I have already mounted, that's why you can see unmount drive here. So when you place your cursor here, it asks for you to mount your drive. You click on that so that your drive will be mounted. Okay? Yeah, path, I will tell you which path is to be copied. I tell you, click on that. You will be seeing that you need to give permission. You give permission. So once you give permission, you will be able to see this folder like this. Like this will come. Is it okay, Ms. Revathi? Is it okay? Ms. Neha will come to your doubt. I will clear it. Please wait. Ms. Revathi, is it okay? Yes. Yeah. Now you click on the drive, navigate where you have put your data set. Go inside your My Drive, wherever you have put your data set, you navigate inside that, right? And you go inside your folder where you have kept the data set. See, I have kept it inside that Collab notebooks, right? So let me search that Collab notebooks here. Yeah, you can see that Collab comes. So you go inside that. You need to click once only. Then inside that again, you have a dataset folder, right? You can see so many folders available here. You have that datasets folder, right? You can see the datasets. Click inside that. Go inside that. Now you have got that file. Now I'll come to you, Ms. Neha. Now you have the file. Right click on that file, copy path. I hope you have done till that. Okay, right click on the file, you copy that path. Okay, now yeah, you have the path available with you. Don't do anything, I tell you what to do, right? So now we are going to import the data set into this Collab environment. You close this. Now you don't need this, right? You close it. So what you need is, you need to type the name, a variable name, let's say COVID is equal to the data frame name, right? Is equal to, yeah, you have something called, you already imported, have you imported pandas? No, you haven't imported pandas. That should be the first step, right? Import your pandas. Import, same thing as we did earlier. Import pandas as PD. You can see that suggestion here coming. PD is the convention used for pandas. You execute that cell. Execute that cell. Now, what you can do here is, you can type that COVID, the name of the file, which you wish. If you want to put your own name, you can put your own name, whatever it is you can do, right? So now PD dot, read CSV is going to be the function which you use for importing it, read underscore CSV. use that. You put a parenthesis, right? Then you put a single quotes or double quotes, whatever you wish, we can do that. Okay, I have used double quotes. Now, the thing which you have copied there now, paste it. Okay, you have the thing which you have copied there, you paste it. So that path will come there. Have you done till this? Right? You need to use that function. You need to use that function read underscore CSV, right? That is available inside pandas. And you need to assign it to a variable called COVID. Hope you have done till now. Okay, so execute that. That's it. Your data set has been loaded to our Google Collab environment. Now you can play with your data. Okay, now we can play with your data. Now, how many of you have done till now? Please respond. How many have done till now? Sir, give 5 minutes. Yeah, now it's a time for a break. I will give you 10 minutes break. So those who haven't done till now, you already this file is shared with you. You can refer that file, right? And you can do that, right? So let me have a 5 minutes break. Google 5 minutes timer. Yes.
Sir, yeah, somebody want? Sir, actually you have shared the file. I have downloaded, yeah. And then shall I?
No need to download. Madam, no need to download that. Once you download, what happens is, once you download, the updates which I do, you won't be able to see. You can view that file.
What are the steps?
Refresh it.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, refresh it.
I have done all the steps. But I show the, actually in the drive which shows, and then in the drive also, all the thing whatever you have said, I have done. But it does not show the files, the collab, something. Just a mix in the middle. That's what I cannot.
Yeah, madam, we do one thing. After the break, could you please share you please try once again. You share your screen so that we will correct it.
Okay, sir.
Yeah, now we have to 10 minutes break.
But actually, I am doing it in different mail. It is not a problem. Shall I share and copy it from there?
Yeah, you ma'am, you do one thing. You just share your screen. We will try to correct it.
Okay, sir.
Yes, Ms. Farah, you can type your concerns there. Email. Any queries, if you have, you can type. I hope all of you have uploaded your data set into your Collab environment, right?
Yeah. Well, see, in this, actually, sir, can you able to hear me, sir?
Yeah, I can see your screen. But where is the code, actually? And the code, I am asking. There is a code.
Code. Just a minute, sir.
Yeah, code you haven't typed.
Yeah.
Here, yeah, fine. Now you, now you navigate to your folder where your data set is there. No, it is not mounted yet. Please. It is not mounted yet. You go to left side, okay. Left, mounted. Okay. I hope you have uploaded your data set into this particular mail.
Right? Google Drive, yeah. Sir.
Give permission, yes.
Hey,
you can
back.
This? Okay. Yeah, please. Now you click on that folder again, folder. No. Okay. Yeah, click on the folder again. Folder, top folder link, no? At the middle you can see, yeah.
Is correct, sir?
Yes. it already loaded. You can see something called drive there, right? Can you see the drive, something there? Otherwise, you control F and not click on that. Don't click on that. So that is for uploading, that is different. Don't click on that. You just close the window. Close the window. Yeah. Click on the folder there.
Yes, sir.
Just type Control F. Just type Control F and search for drive. Type drive. Yeah. Inside that. Inside my drive.
Yes, I'm actually,
it's take time. I will take time. Yeah. I hope you understood, right? Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Yep. So that I can resume sharing.
Here it's not that, sir.
Yeah, please mute, ma'am, if you have done. Yeah. Sir, where can we get the free marketing and finance data for analysis? You need to search now. Even Google data sets are available. Kaggle is there. UCI is another repository area where you will get the data. This is not related to our the current session, but still I'll tell you, there are a lot of repositories available. Like UCI is maintaining a data set, a repository. UCI means University of California, Irvine. So they maintain a lot of data sets. In Kaggle, you can find out a lot of data sets. You go to Kaggle, search there, you will get data sets. And Google data, simply you click Google data sets, Google itself will give you a lot of data sets. These are some of the sites I know. If you want to get image data sets, you can go for ImageNet. Again, Kaggle also, you will get image data sets. Yes. So I hope I have answered. Please share the recordings, it's useful. Yeah, these are the areas where you can get, you know, your data sets. This is a UCI site. Most of the data here will be tabular data, .csv files, and chances are less for getting images. Then now you have the Google data set search, search Google. Here you can find what you need. Actually, you need finance data, right? Marketing and finance data. You type it there, you will get it. And finance data, you can see that when you type marketing itself, you could see a lot of data, right? And financing, you can type that keyword also, so that that will show up. Okay. What is the shortcut for code? I don't understand. I don't understand your question. You're asking what actually? Related with? Oh, you are asking the shortcut for this, this one, right? Yeah. You can see that. Control plus. Yeah. You know, you simply have to type that, otherwise, you can control plus MB, right? Pandas, you don't have to add anything, but if you are installing in your system, you need to install that Pandas library. Otherwise, what you can do is, you know, in Colab, everything is installed for you. That's why for this workshop, when somebody asked whether any prerequisite is needed, I told you that not at all, right? Everything is installed for you. You need to simply use import Pandas as PD, right? Like what you can see in the screen. We require the recordings to learn who you are slow. And of course, they will be sharing the recordings, I guess. So now, but I am, you know, slowly I'm talking, taking a lot of time. I would have finished a lot of topics if I have, you know, got much more time. So now, you try to read the data like this, right? I hope you, those who have finished until this, you execute that so that your data frame will be available, right? So this you called as, you know, data frame, right? So you have something called in Pandas called data frame. How will you know that? So you put type of that COVID, right? You print that type of that COVID. You can see that it is a pandas.core.framework data frame object. What do you mean by data frame? So data frame indicates that you have rows and columns, right? So data frame, it's a 2D kind of object, right? 2D object, or you can say that you have got rows and columns, right? So that's the reason why we say it has got the capabilities of NumPy, right? Two dimensional array, right? So we say it is built on top of NumPy, right? So how will you get the information about the data set. You type the name of the data set, COVID. You put a dot there. You get a lot of methods. You need to get the information of this data set, right? For that, you can put, you can type something called info there, so that you'll be able to see the information. Is this going to be a method? So you need to enclose a parenthesis. This is your information about the data set which you have downloaded right now. So how many rows are there? How many columns are there? Right. So I will tell you how to understand this data. Please give me a minute. Now I will tell you how to understand this data. Right? So you look here. This data set consists of 43,705 entries starting from 0 to 43704. Right? That many rows will be there, or that many samples will be there. Okay. Now you scroll down. These are the columns. How many columns are there? 41 columns are there, right? You have ISO code, continent, location, date, new cases, total cases, all those things. Total deaths, new deaths, right? Okay. So per day cases, I believe from December 31 is there. So you can examine that. How will you examine that? And imagine, you have how many data available? 43705 data available, right? What you can see here, 43446, that means what? The remaining values are, how many values are remaining? The values remaining are, is going to be 43705 minus 43446. So those values are going to be your missing values. So how many missing values are there? You can see that 259 missing values are there inside for this particular column, ISO underscore code. Have you understood the interpretation? 259 missing values are there for this particular thing. Similarly, you can check all those. Okay. We'll come to that. So to find out the missing values in your data set, right? To find out the missing values in your data set, what you can do is you can make use of a function called your data set COVID dot is null. Missing value means what? Null values, right? Is NA, right? And you need to get it column wise, right? Column wise, how many missing values are there? So missing values, to find missing values column wise. So to find missing values column wise, you can put this COVID dot is NA dot sum, so that you will be getting the column wise missing values. Can see each column has got a lot of missing values, but you can see that location and date, there is not a single missing value. Why? Because location, it may be, we will check what is location, right? So until this, have you all done? I'll give you time. We talked about information, getting the info about your data set or description about your data set. Use that method info. Now you understood how to get the null values. So this much, I'm waiting for your response. Those who are done, please type yes or done there in the chat window. Yeah, I got enough replies. Thanks. Now, how to treat a missing values? It's a separate entity. We will come to that, right? So you can replace this missing values by, let's say, mean average of that. There are a lot of techniques, like you can replace it with zeros, right? So a lot of techniques are available. You simply have to use one method, covid.fillna. That is a method you need to use, right? And if you put fillna inside that, if you put zero, all the missing values will be replaced by zeros. So what is the method? I will tell you. Don't do that now. Perhaps you can do that. You can assign it to another data set, COVID, without missing value, WMV, right, is equal to what I'm trying to do here. Now, COVID dot fill NA. So I'm going to fill with the zero. All the missing values will be replaced with this zero, right? Now, after that, you can go for this. You can check that whether any missing values are there. Now you can check. Right now you can check whether any missing values are there or not. The same code I have copied there. You can see that. Yeah, we are trying to check the missing value in the same dataset, but we should check it in the new dataset, right? So what is your new dataset without missing values? Okay, this we have assigned that to without missing values. You check it. You could see that no missing values are there because all the missing values are replaced by zero. Have you understood it? I will give you time to do this. You do this like this. You assign the data set to another variable. Okay, I will give you time, 1 minute time. Please do it. I will wait for your response so that I can reply. I can continue. So have you done till this? Have you tried to replace a missing value with zeros? Yeah, have you understood? Is the pace okay? I'm going very slowly. Okay. Okay, those are done, but what you can do here is we analyze more about the data, right? So how the data looks like. Now we treated the missing value. I told you how to treat the missing value. We see that. Now we look more into the data, right? Suppose we need to see the first few values of this data. Let's say first five rows. You want to get the first five rows. What you do? So your data set is going to be COVID. This consists of missing value, but I am using the same data set. Dot head, and inside that, you know, head default, it will get 5, right? 5 values for you. If you want to get 10 values, you can put 10 there so that you will get the first 10 values. So execute that. You can see the first 10 rows starting from 0, right? You could see the first the continent. You can see North America. And there is some location or country called Aruba, I don't know, right? Likewise, the daily value, right? You could see that from 13/3/2020, you can see the total number of cases, the new cases, all the things are written there, right? Hope you understood how to get the top 10 values of COVID data set. Fine. You can get even the last few values, right? How will you do that? COVID dot, you have something called tail. So by default, I think it will get you last five rows. You can see last five rows. So what is a NIN? NIN indicates dash. What is that? NIN. You can see a lot of NINs there. That indicates dash. What is it? The NIN indicates. Hello. What is this NIN indicates? Not a number exactly. Not a number. That means a missing value. We talked about missing value, right? How to find out the missing value? How to treat the missing value? Yeah. This, remember this data set, we haven't done anything. We have treated, we have found, replaced the missing value with zero, and we have assigned it to another data set. You could see that. We have assigned it to COVID_WMV, right? When you analyze that data set, you could see that the missing values will be replaced by this NIN will be replaced by zeros. Let's see that, right? So what is your new data set? COVID without missing value, right? Dot tail. Now you can see that those missing values are replaced by zeros. You can see, no? All the missing values are replaced by zeros. Fine. Okay. But this is our new data set. We have done in both areas. So original data set and the replaced data set. Okay. Hope you understood this, please. Okay. So we talked about data frame, right? Because it consists of rows and columns. Now we talk about another pandas object called series. So let's talk about a pandas object called series. Okay, so let us do one thing. I just want to get the country name or the location. I need to get that. What will I do, right? So I can type country is equal to, it's a variable, right? Country is equal to, what is a data set name? COVID, right? COVID of, what is a column name? Yeah, you put a single quote, so you can see all the column names listed there. So you select the column name, which consists of the country names, you know that it's going to be location, right? So little bit of data set knowledge is needed, domain knowledge is needed. Without that, you cannot work on it. Okay, nobody can teach you the domain knowledge, that you should develop by yourself. And now what happens is, let us take, let's run this. Now you type, you check the type of this country, what it will be? It will be a series, right? Why? Because it consists of, it's just like a vector, we can say. It consists of, no, when you print it, you will say it has only, yeah, one dimension, or you can say one column only, right? You can see that this is index. Apart from that, you can see that series has only one column. Let's just like a vector, right? The different country names. Why it is repeated? Why? Because it is a daily report, right? So if you want to get the unique kind of thing, there may be function to get, yeah, unique, right? So if you print that, you will get the unique lists. Yeah, this much country list you have, right? This much is going to be your country list. Have you understood this much? Sir, I have one missing value related doubt. Suppose I have a number plate image, some number is partially erased or extraction of that value can be. Now, my question is, do you have it as image or data set? CSV or image? In that case, it is difficult, you know. This method cannot be adopted. So, image, if you find a missing value in the number plate, I don't think that it is convenient method to replace that with zero. That does not make any sense. Yeah, that does not make any sense. Why? Because normally we replace it with zero or replace it with average value. So, replacing with the mean value or average value is the most common way of doing things. So, in your case, I don't think that it is feasible. Anyhow, we can replace with zero, but still, since it's a number plate kind of thing, I don't think that it will be feasible. So, when it is a quantitative value and all, you can replace with mean value, so it won't have much problem. Can I have the data of India only out of this? Yeah, we will come to that. Please wait. We'll take everything, right? You need to have data of India, right? She said, does she want to have data of India? Yeah. We will see that now. Since you are curious enough, I wanted to talk a lot of other things, but since you are curious enough, we can go for that now, right now, right? So for that, you need to learn something called group by, which you have learned in your database, SQL kind of thing. The same thing, right? So what you can do here is you can group by COVID dot, we can use it group by method. Group by method. Inside that, you know, you can group by which column? You need to group by your country, right? The country column. The country is denoted by location. We already mentioned that, right? And what you need to see? Do we want to see the depth, right? If you want to see the depth, you can go there and you can take that. From the information, you will be able to see that. Yeah, let me take that information for you. It is going to be total depth is there, new depth is there. Let me take new depth. Okay. So let me take new depth. Right. Fine. And you want to get the sum, right? So that you will be getting the total number of depths. So you just copy it into a variable. Let's say depth. So once again, I explain what I have done is I have used a group by method. So group by which column? I need to group by location or the country, right? Now, what is going to be your value, right? The value column should be that new depth. Why? Because I need to find out the total number of depths, right? So that's the reason why this column I have selected. So this indicates a column to group by, and this indicates the value, right? The value column. And you are going to find out the sum of this particular column, the value column. So first comes the group, using which you can group by, and the next one will be the you can summarize it on this value column. Okay. Now why are you asking this kind of, how can we add layers in CNN? That comes in day after tomorrow session, right? CNN, how to add layers. We will talk about that, right? Please wait. I think you have a schedule with you, right? This is, we are not at all talking about CNN now. Yeah. So now you will be having something called depth there, right? So you can print out few values of depth. See what happens. Yeah, you can see that. See, Afghanistan, total number of deaths, you can see 1420. Albania, you could see the total number of deaths. Algeria, you could see the total number of deaths. You can verify whether it is same or not, no? You can go to Google and you can ask them whether it is same or not, right? So let us take our country's case. How will you find out? Death of, what is going to be the index? The index is going to be India, right? So let's see what is. You can see that 79,722. Is it correct? Let's search. Might be more because I don't know whether it is up to date data set. May not have today's data, but still we will search. COVID death India. Please call little. Yeah, I will give you time. Please wait, sir. You want to verify. Yeah, it is around 80,000 now. I told you this is not the most recent data, but you got the value which is near. It might be yesterday's data, right? So, but based on that, you got the value near to that, 79,722. So let us take my favorite countries, right? You know my favorite country, right? It's going to be Somalia, right? So let's take Somalia's. It's only 98, right? So let's search. So are they better than us? I don't know. So let us search Somalia. Yeah, you can see that. You can verify that. How many deaths are there? Oh. You can see in Somalia only 98 deaths. Right? You can see that. The same thing what we got it. Right? The same 98. Okay. Now you have the time to do this many things. So what I have done is I already told you have to group by the column, and based on which column value you need to group by, that means you should have some value there. Then I understand. I already have the domain knowledge of the data. I know that new deaths will contain the per day deaths. Okay, and you need to aggregate it. You need to find out the sum so that you will get the total sum. That's it, right? Have you understood? Yes or no? I will give you now time to do this. You can search your favorite country's total number of deaths. Yeah, your question is, sir, location is column name, whereas Nuda, this, that is also column name. I told you that that column will contain values. So you can see that. You see, you know, the location, in location you could see some country names, right? So, or whether it is international or kind of thing, right? It is available in location. But when you scroll right, you can see in New Death, right? Yeah, you can see the New Death, it consists of this many values. So, the New Death column, I will select the New Death column for you, okay? I will show the New Death column for you. COVID of, no, when you put double quotes, you can see all the columns listed there, or single quotes, not double quotes, both are same, but you, if you put single quotes, it will show that. No cases, when you print that, you will see that. Yeah, you can see that, no? Death on each day, you can see. This is a column. Initially, it is NINY because you know that initially there were no deaths reported in many countries. So that's why you can see not a number there. I hope I have answered Ms. Teju. Ms. or I don't know, Teju 3862. Scroll up, right? Where I have to scroll up? Sir, this code is already shared with you. Could you please, some of you, could you please share that link again to Dr. Sonal? Could you please? Yeah, it's already there. Thank you. Yeah, shall I move forward? Have you all understood? Is it boring or is it interesting? Or shall I move forward like this? Please give me a feedback. Yeah, thank you. Thank you for your response. Wonderful, wonderful response, right? Yeah. Yeah, today, now we will explore more things about this, right? So we try to plot this. So suppose you want to plot this death, you know, series which you got, right? You know that, the death one, right? So we try to plot that. How will you try to plot that? Okay. So you see, let's, you select, you know, death dot plot, right? Then, yeah, you give that, you know, it's a series data file, series object, death is a series object. So let's see what happens. You can see that, right? In United States, you could see the maximum number, even it crossed almost near to 2 lakhs or close to 2 lakhs, I don't know. Or near to 2 lakhs, right? You can see that spikes, right? Okay. You got a brief summary about that. Okay. So this will give you, that's the reason why we say that, see, we haven't used the plt.show, that's why this thing comes. The plt.show is extremely important. So that will won't, right? And you can give X label, Y label, title and all those things. You can add into this. This is a line plot, nothing else. Okay, connecting all the data points. You can have a scatter plot also. How will you do that? Yeah. You can have inside plot, you can have something called kind, I think. It's equal to, but suggestion is not coming. Yeah, it's equal to scatter. It is not, scatter is not available, I think. And is, yeah, it is not working right. You can have line plot only. For data frame, you can have it, we will show that. Yeah. How to plot for selected countries? Yeah, that's a good question. You need to have selected countries explored, right? So, first thing you can do is you can select those countries into a new variable, right? Otherwise, you can do one thing. What do you do here is your death, new death. Let me take selected death, right? Selected death is going to be death of, yeah, you need to have you need to have India, right? Then comma, which else you can put, let's say United States, right? United States. Yeah. So you just have that, those things, right? Just key error is there. So yeah, I just do one thing. Just try to append it. Yeah, I just try to append that, right? Now let me go for that selected death. Yeah, you got the, what happens here is you have added those two values. When you apply that plus here, what happens is, instead of appending, what it does is it adds the total number of death in both these countries, right? So if you want to have a separate plot, what you can do here is you can India's, you can give the death of India, you can give it in one variable, right? There may be better code available, but this is according to my logic, right? So you can say USA death here. Let's say sorry. Is equal to what you should define a variable. Let's say USA underscore death. Okay, now you have two variables, right? So now we can have a plot. Why the plot only showing five locations? Yeah, it randomly, because it takes the maximum value, minimum, and randomly it takes. But you have, why? Because it has got a lot of values, right? You cannot even, how many values are there? You can see when you click on this unique, right? How many country names are there? We want to see that. You display that length of this. So we'll be getting how many countries are there. How many countries are there? Imagine how many countries will be there. You see 212 countries, right? Or the locations across the globe, right? So that much data is available. That, you cannot represent that 212 things in this. I hope I have answered. Two selected countries in the same plot. Yeah, right now we are having two selected countries in the same plot, right? We will have it. Please wait. So what you can do here is you can have something called subplot. Okay. So in subplot, or you can rather, you can have a quantitative variable, not a categorical one. So this is a quantitative one. So it's better to have a relationship between this. So you can either you can have a plot itself. Let's go for that. Plot. And India. India underscore death. Right? And you have, yeah, PLT not defined. I think you need to import that matplotlib.pyplot as PLT. It might not be there. That's why it's showing error. You can have USA underscore death. So now it is not India underscore death. It is something. I think I haven't executed this, right? Yeah. It is not promoted. I don't know. It is. Yeah. Can we have a list using where? Yeah, of course you can have. Of course you can have a list, and yeah, that is a good method. You can have a list and you can plot it, right? So let us have that selected. That is equal to. We are right now plotting on the series data, so there are problems. So selected this is equal to a list of two values. Okay. So now we can have PLT. Or rather, you can have selected death dot plot. Okay, so it should be capitalized. It's a list. Actually, you cannot pass a list into this. What you need to do here is you need to use PLT dot plot, and you pass that better than it's a plt dot plot. You pass that selector underscore death. Yeah, you pass that. Be able to see that. Yes, you can see that, right? When you put that plt dot show, it will come to. So what it indicates is these are the values. These are the values. So you need to have the sum value, right? Sum, isn't it? So the sum value, it's in India it is 79 at near to 80,000, right? And in the USA it is around more than 1,80,000 or near to 2 lakh, right? That is what the count in USA is all about. Okay. So you can have a better plot. You can have a scatter plot. So for scatter plot, you need to change this to that. You will be saying that you have a list only, so you cannot have the scatter plot. If you want to have a scatter plot, you need to put this these two entities differently. Like this x value should give here, and the y value, comma y value. The y value is going to be this one. Copy it and this. You can see the when you put the scatter plot, what happens? Yeah, this is totally irrelevant. Why? Because it considers x and y. We don't want that. We want the other one, right? We want the line plot only. This is totally irrelevant to our case here. So that is not at all relevant, right? This is, it tries to find out the relationship between x and y. We don't want to. What happens here is you can see that in India it comes around near to 80,000. You can see this, and in US it comes around 1,95,000. That's why you can see a scatter plot here, right? So depending upon your need, so this find out a relationship, right? So here it is irrelevant. You don't have to find out the relationship between these two, right? So here the line plot will be better, so that you will try to see the cases. Similarly, you can have many countries in between. You can connect many countries. Let's say if you add if you add one more country, let's say depth of which country you need. Somalia you already know, right? It is I think it is better to give a value in between. Why? Because the maximum is that of USA, right? So probably we can take Brazil. That lies in between ours and the United States, right? So Brazil is going to be probably it starts with the capital letter. I don't know, right? I am simply guessing, right? So let us do that. So now we have three values. Let's see what happens. Yeah, now yeah, you can see a bend here, right? Right, you can display the value of Brazil, how it will be. You can display all the values, right? For that you have something called some attributes called marker. Let me define it, something called marker, not map. So line style, not here, inside the plot you have something called marker. So they will come to know the data. Marker, yeah, equal to, let's say, star. Okay, so let's put this. Hopefully it will work. Yeah, this will show error. I don't know. It is not marker, it is something else. I don't remember that actually. We need to go to the plot so that we'll be able to see the plot inside robot map. We cannot learn everything, right? Depending upon our use, we need to put, right? So depending upon your questions, I am doing things. Like you are giving me assignment. Yeah, I haven't got using marker. I don't know. You are giving me assignment, I am doing things, assignment, right, for you. Probably you can search in Matplotlib whether what is the right argument to choose. Probably you can give that. Yeah. So fill style. Yeah, marker is there. I think why it is not. But let me take this example marker so that we can see the much more example. What are values you can give for marker? Yeah, you can see that you can give we take so marker, you can give any value, but I don't know why I have got this error. Probably the star. Yeah, now you got it, right? You can see that star. Right, and even you can change your marker color. There is option to change the marker color. Even marker size also you can change. Marker face color. You can see that marker face color. So these are keyword arguments. That means order is not at all important. You can put it in anywhere, right? We call it as keyword arguments. The KW star star KW args, right? So marker face color. Let us put it as red. Okay, let's see. Yeah, you can see those stars in red color, right? Okay, and even line style also you can put something like the line style is there. You cannot by heart everything, you need to go there and you need to find out. Yeah, line style, see that line style. You can use that line style there and you use that line style inside this. Let us put line style as let's say the dash line. There is no difference, right, when I put it like this. So one more dash, let me put one more dash, see what happens. Yeah, you can see the line style has been changed, right? The marker, you can see the star, and the marker face color also you can see some, you know. Then marker, you can put it as O there, right? Or circle there. Let's see one. Yeah, big O will create problem. Probably it is small O. Yeah, there are some predefined values. You need to keep that. Yeah, now you can see it. It is better, right? So this corresponds to that of India, right? This corresponds to that of Brazil, right? And this corresponds to that of US. Have you understood it? Yes or no? And you can give X label, Y label, all those things. Even X ticks, Y ticks. X ticks means what? You can replace this, you know, and give values. Show the code. Yeah, this is it. See, these are the things I haven't prepared at all. Based on your requirements, I am doing the code, right? Like you are putting assignment for me, or rather you are testing me, you are examining me, right? By putting questions, I am doing things for you, right? I wanted to talk a lot of things, even more than this, but based on your interest, I am doing things. Okay. So never ever by heart things. If at all you want to learn something, you go there and official documentation page, you try to find it out, right? Whatever you needed, I have told you. Arcs and KW arcs and all the reference I already mentioned. Keyword arguments. The beauty is that this is a keyword argument. Why? Because this is, you call it as a key, and this is a value corresponding to that. The beauty is that you can put this even beyond that, right? Unknowingly Malayalam word comes in between. So you can put in between, in before this, right? Right? You can put it like this. No problem will happen. So that's why it is known as keyword arguments. Why? Because position is not at all important. Star star KW arcs. Right? But this is important. No, you cannot skip this, because this is a positional argument. Star args. Right? So if you understand these basics, how to read a function documentation correctly, then everything is easy for you. Yeah, everything is stored in the drive also. That's another advantage. Sir, what value x-axis represents? Yeah, x-axis is what actually? Here in this case, you have, in y-axis you have total number of deaths. The x-axis you don't have much, you don't have anything. You simply have some, you need to have countries, right? You need to have country names in the x-axis. If you want to have country names in the x-axis, you can do one thing. You can give that, right? You can give that. How will you give that? X-axis. So let's put another list. India, right? Then which country comes next? Brazil, right? Then comma, what is the next country? United States. Okay, so now we can see, now x-axis has been changed. Is it okay, ma'am? Who asked this? Arunava Kumar. Is it okay, sir? Yeah. How do we save this figure in .eps? I don't know .eps, but you can save it. Definitely you can save it in other kind of formats, less like you have that. Let me use that figure dot. You have something called fig dot. No, elt dot save. I don't know whether it's there. But for subplots, you can save it. Save fig is there. Save fig, and what name you need, right? Your name. COVID analysis or whatever it is you can give. And you can save it as PNG or JPEG. I don't know. EPS, I haven't heard about. Can we save the figure in PDF? I haven't tried that. PNG, I have tried. Or JPEG, you can do that. Probably it will be saved, I think. Yeah. You click on this folder, no? You click on this folder symbol. It will be available. Or you go inside your Colab notebook. You can see whether it is created or not. Now this will be created in the folder where you are currently working, right? That means it will be created inside the content thing, right? So, yeah, you can see now this figure COVID analysis load JPEG has been. Again, you are giving me assignment. I am doing the assignment. Okay. Okay. I tell you, I haven't seen this in any FDP where the audience is throwing questions and the presenter is trying to answer those questions, right? FDPs, what happens is presenter will come up with some preparation and try to solve. No, I'm not boasting about myself, but still, but that is what happening here. You have, you can download this file. Click on this and download this. You can save it anywhere you want, right? You can send it to your friend. Okay. Hope I have answered. I don't know about EPS format. What is that actually? I don't know. The things which I don't know, I should say I don't know, right? Other than bluffing around. You can say a bit about that. EPF, EPS, right? Interaction is, yeah. Thank you. Especially in online classes, this component is missing. Interaction kind of thing. And I am also on the learning curve. Since I am dealing with this data science and machine learning for the past two years, does not mean that I am an expert on this. I am learning many things each day. I am learning new things. Right? You cannot, you cannot be. Nobody can be an expert on all these things. You try to learn a lot of things from great people. So that's what I do quite often. No. I hope it's clear till now. So now, right now, we do some summary statistics, right? So we are going to do some summary. You can try, sir, whether you can save it in EPS, encapsulated PostScript. Yeah, you can try it, whether you can save it. Maybe, should I try? Yeah, we will try it. If you want, you can try it. Whether you can save it. I think it has been saved, right? Yes, it has been saved. You can do that. Okay. File will be available. You can double click on that. You can see that. Yeah, it has been downloaded for you. How will you open it? That's another question, right? Yeah, this file. That's not, you need separate app, I think. Which app will you use? No, I'm asking you some questions. Which app will you use for opening this? Which application? EPS viewer. Yeah, you may need to download all those things. I don't wish to do that now. I can, you can try this, sir. I can try this and we can do this. Okay. Fine. Acrobat, yeah, will perform. I don't know. Yeah, it may be there. Right. Fine. So I hope so far you can change the line style, you can even change the color of the line. A lot of options are available here, right? Never ever by heart. You cannot even by heart all the things here. You try, make a trial and error method. That's all with the plot. There is not much concept. You should know how to plot a thing. Not much concept is there, right? Even you can put on x-axis, you can put the title. On y-axis, you can put the title. Even for this figure itself, you can put the title. A lot of things you can do. Play around it. Okay. So now we try to find out some summary statistics. Summary stats. Okay. So what do you mean by summary stats, right? So I need to find out the details about the death, right? Some summary about the death. So you have that death thing available, right? Like death series available for you, right? So let us do that. On that, let us apply describe. Okay, describe is a kind of thing which will give you the summary statistics. That means it gives you some of the main important components of when you deal with statistics. The most important things, the count, total number of values. You already observed that 212 countries are there, right? The mean value, that means average death across 212 countries, is going to be 8,723, right? Across the whole countries, when you take, right? You can even take continent wise average. You can compare which continent is having a less death rate. You can compare, but these things I tell you, I don't know whether the country like China, whether they will give the full death result and all. We cannot trust any country, right? you know, US, they say that they are transparent, they are giving all the data, but I don't know whether it's same with China, right? So you cannot, but still based on the available data, you can make an analysis. Which continent is better? You can do a kind of analysis, like in terms of COVID deaths, which continent is better? Even you can perform something on the cases. These are all, you know, prescriptive kind of analysis which you have learned in the first session of the day, right? You can do all those things. And this analysis, the specialty is that you are doing something on the past and present data. But if you want to predict on this, then comes the machine learning part. Then comes a time series analysis. Why? Because, you know, you can predict this. And the time series component, I think you will be having a session on Friday where you will be analyzing, I guess, time series analysis will be done. Okay. Now, yeah, standard deviation, you know, standard deviation means the deviation from that mean value. You find it out using the formula. Which formula will you use to find out the standard deviation? X minus, then you have an observation X, X minus mu, where mu is the average, divided by x minus mu, the whole square, divided by total number of observations. You take the summation of all those things and then you get the standard deviation, right? So the standard deviation, you can see, simply gives a deviation from the mean value, right? So that is going to be 65,840. These are the wonderful figures, especially when you need to have statistics knowledge also before model building and all. That is important. You cannot straight away go inside machine learning without learning linear algebra and statistics. So for statistics, these values are extremely important. The minimum value, minimum depth is zero. And 25% means it is an interquartile range, right? The first interquartile range is going to be a 25%. So next is going to be a 50%, the next interquartile range. And the next interquartile range is going to be the 75%. You can see that the percentile and the maximum depth, the maximum value, 9247.04. That means the maximum value means, what is that? 924704. What does it indicate? The maximum value 924706 indicates what? I think I have shared with Biju sir. You can ask them. I shared all the yesterday's code with Biju sir. You can ask them. I already shared. If you want right now itself, I will share you. Please wait. Remain me towards the end of the session, so that I will share it. Yeah, it is going to be a total total depth, right? So that's it for you. Now we do one thing. Now we talked about pandas, we talked about the summary statistics. You can get summary statistics of each and every column like this, right? You know, since we only found out the depth like this, we could find it out, right? So you can go for summary statistics, per day summary statistics also, you can find it out. Okay, so suppose you need to find out an outlier. What do you mean by an outlier? Outlier means, yeah, whether this consists of a negative value in the depth. Is it possible to have a negative value in the depth? Right now we are going to focus on some outlier analysis. You already found talked about missing value analysis. So outlier analysis means you are asking how to get the summary statistics in a table format. I don't know, sir. You may have to search. I don't know. Okay. Yeah. you know. If maybe you can save this into another file. You can save it into another file and then you can import as a PDF or but still I don't know whether you will be getting it as a table format. I don't think so. You may have to table format. I don't think that you need to check. I haven't worked with that. How to get description of particular country? Yeah, you can get that column name, you can get so that, but that is useless. Why? Because summary statistics we will incorporate with the quantitative measure. Country is not at all a quantitative measure. Do you agree? Country means it's a categorical value. India, US and all those things are categorical values. So do you apply a summary statistics to a categorical value? You don't do that, right? So you apply summary statistics to a quantitative value, a quantitative variable. Okay. So now we are going to perform some outlier analysis. Outlier means what? You call it as a noise or out of the range data, right? You also call it as out of the range data. That means, suppose a negative value, example I am going to tell you, suppose a negative value is there in the death. Is it possible to have a negative death? Negative value in new_death column. new_death or something like that, right? There is a column name. So is it possible to have a negative value for death in COVID data set? Not at all, right? Your intelligence will say that it is not at all possible. But the person who is working on this data, he might have had some brandy or rum or something, right? So he might have typed some negative value and by mistake, right? I'm simply saying a joke only, right? Don't take it seriously. So he might have typed it by mistake, right? Okay, so that can be a possibility, right? Negative value, the mistakes done by the person who is going to enter the data, right? So now, what you can do here? So what you can do here is you can find it out. Okay, so how will you find it out? Whether your new death has got some, negative values or not? How will you find it out, right? So that you can find it out. Let's see, right? Now, let us define it as outlier check, a variable name, right? You put as outlier is equal to. So your data set name is COVID, right? COVID data set of, which is your column name. The column name is going to be new death, right? New deaths, yeah. Here comes the importance of something we learned yesterday. I told you can use this conditional operators, which is extremely useful. And you want to check whether any value is there less than zero. See the beauty of this. You don't have to use a for loop at all, right? It is quite far efficient, isn't it? So the beauty of that NumPy, the somebody asked me, why do you teach NumPy? You can straight away go to Pandas. See, you should understand that since you have that array capability of NumPy, the pandas can make use of it, right? Okay, so now we can check whether any such outlier is there or not, right? So we have found out, we have checked whether any value is there which is less than zero. That means you can see that this will give you true or false per row, right? So you can go for one thing, you can check the len of such thing, right? So you do one thing, you index that outlier check, you index that COVID, let me do one thing, you are going to index that, right? COVID off, right? You are using this as an index, this much you are using as an index. Okay, that means you are putting inside square bracket. Then this is your data frame name. Now let's check whether any outlier is there or not. You cannot see that, you need to print that. Then only you will be able to see that, right? So let us put that outlier check. Yeah, this shows that there is serious error, right? Some kind of serious error has happened while entering the data. You could see some negative values. You can check it out. Where is the negative value? Yeah, you can see that, right? You can see new deaths -1, -3. What kind of blunder it is? It might have happened due to some mistakes. This is a case where you need to have a domain knowledge. You need to ask them whether it's a mistake or whether it's a typing mistake or whether it's a deliberate unconscious mistake, just like I have mentioned. The person who is entering the value, they might have had something else, right? So if I do to that, you cannot trust, right? How it can be -31? No, how it can be, right? So that's the case, and these values you need to treat. Okay, so you need to remove all those values. And you need to put all those the values inside those negative less than zero, you need to replace it with a zero value. If it is a typing mistake, you need to put, no, if it is a serious mistake, right? you need to put that replace all those minus 1 minus 3 by zeros. Have you understood? Yes or no? Have you understood it? Yes or no? Yes. So this is what outlier analysis is all about. And once you find out the outlier, you need to treat the outlier. That's another part of it. Okay. Right. So now you can replace that outlier if it has. You know, let me check the length of how many such fake data or how many such noise is there? Not fake. How many such noise is there? Let me check that. Only 7. Yeah, only 7 values are there. So that might be a mistake for sure. Right? That might be a mistake. You can remove those. How will you remove those? Now you have found out the outlier analysis. Now you half an hour is still remaining. Shall I move forward like this? I expect a response from everybody, please. Now the attendance is 87, so many have left. Yeah. And FDP means it's only for interested people. Like I believe that many FDPs we attend only for getting certificate. And I don't know. I disagree with that concept. Getting certificate. What is the need of? Where will you put the certificate? Might be useful for appraisal, right? Self appraisal. But you won't get the gain in any knowledge. Or might be those people might be having only knowledge just for getting certificate. In that case, it will be fine. Yeah. Thank you for the fine response. Right. Now we are going to treat this outlier. How to treat this outlier? Okay. So you have that outlier underscore check where you can, you know, replace, right? So now you type your data set. What is the data set name? COVID. So let me give a new name for that, without outlier, right? WO, that means without outlier. Okay. So that is equal to, you are going to drop those things, right? COVID dot drop. Right? Yeah, you can use a method called drop, right? And inside that you need to give what you need to drop. So you need to drop those where, yeah, those where this, you have this outlier, right? Isn't it? So you can copy this much, paste it there. Okay, so you can put one thing, this dot index means you are trying to delete all those indices where you have this COVID off. Instead of this, you need to put this outlier, right? We already found out, right? Outlier check. Can put that. You already found out that. So you can straight away put that. So clear check there, right? So then dot index. Yeah. So now you need to put this is a command to replacing that, right? So what happens is that will be dropped, right? So those values will be, the index values of those outlier will be taken, right? Outlier data will be taken. Yeah, using box plot again, you can identify outlier. I agree with you. Absolutely, you can do that. But box plot, I don't know. You can go for box plot, right? No issue, you can go for box plot. You can identify outlier. But this is treating the outlier. and identifying the outlier in this way. That I told you, plot also you can use it for visualization. Fine, you can find out the outlier. This is another way of doing things. The one, you can do the same thing in different ways. It is not necessary that you should do everything in one way, right? So now you can see, you can check for whether any such outlier is there in the new data, right? How will you check that? So you can check it, COVID underscore without outlier, right? Without outlier. So then COVID underscore, without outlier off, right? What is the column name? New deaths. New underscore deaths less than zero. Now you are again trying to find out whether there is any outlier in your new data set. Okay, so you can see that there is no, it returns empty, right? Or you can go for len also, so that will get you the length, whether there is any such data is available or not. You can see that it is zero there, right? Now why we have taken COVID two times over here, outlier check is equal to, why? Because I already mentioned that condition you have to put it inside, that condition you have to put it inside this indexing, right? So that you will be getting this outlier, right? This is indexing. For indexing we are using this much square bracket you are using for indexing, and this is a condition you are using. So only those values which are true, that means only those values which corresponds to this condition which is true, you need to consider those values only. Is that okay? Yeah, that's why yesterday when I mentioned about conditional operators, I told you that this will be extremely good, right? This operator, it is extremely good, right? Many cases you can find out, but you can even check with whether the country which you have intended is same or not. See, another thing is that you are learning everything in Python, right? You have wonderful tools available like Tableau and all, right? Which is easy to learn. Somebody told me you have Boxplot. Yeah, you can get all the data visualization in Tableau. The visualization, you can have an interactive visualization which is easy to learn in Tableau. Again, you have something called Power BI. I haven't used Power BI, but I have tasted some of the things in Tableau, right? But the thing is that Tableau public is free, but it is a paid software. If you need to have Tableau desktop, you need to pay, right? But it is not the case with the Python which you are learning now. It is completely open source. This Power BI also proprietary, it belongs to Microsoft, right? So these are proprietary softwares. These can be also used for data visualization. It is not that you can do data visualization only with Python. No, you can do with R, right, which is again open source. You can do with Tableau, Power BI. See, the beauty of you doing this in Tableau is that you don't require a coding knowledge at all. But I tell you, it is not free. These are proprietary. Right now we are learning Python, Python for machine learning. Why did you tell to download Anaconda when this collab is good? If you want to use, there are people who want to use it and test this thing in their own lab. Probably faculty members, some of them want to install it in their lab so that they can give assignments for their students. Right now those who are engineering college faculties, especially those who are taking S3 for right now third semester students under Kerala Technological University, they have this minor course on machine learning, right? So I think they may need this. They can install everything on their lab if they have a good resource, like for example good amount of RAM and GPU. There may be colleges with all those facilities, so for them I have told, right? And I have our installation script also. If you want, I can share it. Anybody? Okay, and you can do everything in Colab. Even you can do things in Kaggle kernel. Kaggle, there is kernel available. Kaggle called as Kaggle notebook. Now earlier they termed it as kernel, so this is Kaggle notebook, right? So you log in into Kaggle, you can click on new notebook. Again, you can sign in with your Google account, right? Do the things. But the resources which you get in Kaggle would not be same as Colab. You can see that the memory and the other things which you get here is not as same as Colab. It will be a little bit short, right? You can check the memory. Once the resources are allocated, you can check for the memory and all this, right? The same thing, JuPyter notebook, it is available in Kaggle also. Yeah, it's allotted, right? Yeah, this looks more resemble, this resembles more to the JuPyter notebook, right? You can see that the RAM usage, you can see how much it is there for you. You have only maximum 1 GB of RAM, right? Whereas in Colab, how much you had? How much you had? Come on, tell me. Is data safe on Colab if you are doing research on it? It's there in your own private, your own Gmail, but I don't know whether you cannot ask Google whether they are taking data or not. We cannot do that. What is happening in the backend, we don't know, right? Yeah, research on it, but no, probably it will be safe. Why? Because it is in your own personal Gmail account, so I don't think that it will create any issues. But we cannot trust, you know, what happens in the background, we don't know. Whether all those things, you are saving it in Google Cloud. So for workshop, Colab is, yeah, of course, Colab will be there. And actually for researchers, they have done this, actually. Yeah, you have 12 GB of RAM. You are correct, Mr. Mahesh. You have 12 GB of RAM in Colab. But here you only have 1 GB, which is better you offer Colab. Yeah, you can have better visualizations in Tableau. I tell you, you can have a free tutorial on Tableau. It's available in YouTube or anywhere, right? You can have it. It's a wonderful, wonderful tool. You just have to drag and drop things. But the basic understanding is needed. Just like one of you have mentioned, Boxplot is enough for understanding the outlier. Of course, but you need to understand that Boxplot itself, there are a lot of things to be understood. What is the interquartile range? What is going to be the mean? What is going to be the where the outlier lies? So a lot of statistics you need to understand, right? So for that, you can go for this course on Matplotlib or Seaborn. Then finally, you can go for that Boxplot, right? Hope it is clear. And Boxplot you will use when you have a categorical value. Remember that. Okay. So you have plots like count plots. Since you have asked me doubts, I am telling. You have plots like count plot, box plot. These things you will use only for categorical values. Okay. Whereas you use line plot, the thing which you have seen, a scatter plot and all, you use in case of quantitative variables. Have this understanding, right? First, have this understanding. You know, categorical values means you know, right? The country values or they are categorical values. Even yes or no values, categorical value, right? The car brands, let's say Toyota, Tata, and other marriage Suzuki and all, there are category values. Want to ask something? Want to ask me something? Hello? Want to ask me something? No. Right, fine. No, fine. Yeah. This is about outlier handling. We talked about how to handle mixing values, how to handle outliers. We talked about that. No. So we talk about another visualization tool. I think we can talk about Seaborn. Is it okay? Shall I move forward with almost 10 minutes remaining? I can talk about Seaborn also. Will it be okay for you? Yes. Yeah, Seaborn is again built on top of Matplotlib. This is another one fantastic visualization. Python-based package, so you can import Seaborn also, right? So along with Matplotlib, here I think we have imported Matplotlib somewhere. I don't know where we have imported. Yeah, we have imported Matplotlib. Along with that, you can import Seaborn, right? So separately also you can do that, no problem. We'll do here. We will import Seaborn, right? So right now we are going to talk about Seaborn, right? So import Seaborn as SNS. Oh, sorry, you born as SNS. Fine. So execute that. Wait, I got some WhatsApp messages from the coordinators. Let me go through that. Inform attendance is active now. I got this message at 3:40. Now only I am looking at the WhatsApp, and I got many. Yeah, one of your coordinators called me. I don't know for what purpose. If you want to convey anything, you can convey directly. No problem. Now, when I was taking class, I don't take calls. I simply disconnect it. Because again, it is difficult for me to, you know, once I take call again, I have to switch back to this. I don't know about that, Ms. Neha, because I am not coordinating this regarding attendance and all. I don't know. That's okay. That's a warning only. It's okay. Fine. No problem. It's a warning only. It is okay. Here we are going to see something using this Seaborn now. Okay, so let us have a list of cars, right, or car companies. Which are the car companies you are aware of? Tata, you have Ford or Ford, then simply joking only. So now you have something called Toyota, right? So you have this many, right? 3. And let me increase a bit. I need to show you count plot. So let me have 2 Tata cars, right? And 3 Ford cars, right? Okay. It's created a list for you. Now, I told you for categorical value, you can use this count plot. Right, so you can use SNS dot count plot, and you can put that. See here, you need to have keyword arguments. So the first thing is, it should be x is equal to none, right? So you put x is equal to what is the thing you need here? That list name, right? You need to put that list name. Okay, then you need to use plt dot show. Let's see what happens. Yes, you got it right. You got the color. Now you got the count plot. Count plot means you know that Tata cars, 2 cars are there. Ford, you can see 3 cars are there. And Toyota, you can see only 1 car is there. So this is used for categorical value. This count plot is used for categorical value. Okay. Hope you understood. You can have a box plot also, right? How will you find out box plot? SNS dot box plot. You can see that. Again, you will use it for categorical value. Then you would have x is equal to cars or car. What was it? Car, right? I haven't used plt dot show. It will create problem. Reduce. For I think for box plot, for plotting that you need to have a data set also, the data frame also you need to give. Probably you can give something like this box plot x is equal to, let's say, the column name of your COVID data set, right? So let us have the COVID data set column name, let's say new underscore death, right? So new, I will show the code, please wait. I'm just waiting, checking whether that. You will have the death underscore death. Yeah, new underscore death, right? So let me use that new underscore death. Right? And data can be, data is equal to your data set name, that is COVID without outlier, right? Without outlier. Okay. And now in hue means it is another argument where you can put the third variable. You can embed the third variable, right? So we can have the location. The third column name is going to be the location, right? So the country name. So plt.show. Let's do that. Yeah, you can have the box plot of all the countries. You can see that, right? So when you have box plot of all the countries, it will happen, right? So the new deaths, right, of all the countries, it will show like this. But instead of that, you can have a box plot of especially the daily death, right? So it doesn't have much significance. You can have some new other column like total death that is available. Total death or deaths, I don't know. It might be deaths. I need to check the column name. It might be deaths. Yeah, again, total deaths, you plot it, you will be getting something like this, right? So why? Because you have that much data, right? If you try to reduce the number of data, it will be fine. Okay, so here we put instead of this, yeah, you can give like that, box plot x is equal to, yeah, you can give like that. This is another way to do the thing. X is equal to that column name. You don't have to put the entire data set name, you have to put that column name only. That will be fine. Okay. And hue and all, like I have added, I need to have the third variable component. That's why I have added to hue, right? Okay, so let me try with this car, right? So show some error. Yeah, with the one variable, it will show error. Why? Because you need to have that data set and one the column name, you need to put that. Otherwise, it will show error, right? You cannot perform that. So for categorical values only, you will be using this box plot and count plot and all those. And for quantitative analysis, you will be using this. You'll be using that. What to say? Line plot and dash bar plot. You again have one thing called bar plot, scatter plot, and all those things you will be using for quantitative analysis. Okay. So that's all. I think we can stop today. Now, if you have any doubts, you can ask me. It's a time, I think, 4:56. So I think I have covered visualization and analysis preliminary things. We cannot have the entire thing, entire topic this 2 hours or 3 hours of time. We cannot have it, right? We can have only limited components. Now it's up to you. You go to the documentation, official documentation page. You try all those things. It's a trial and error method, right? Especially the plotting. It's a trial and error method. Seaborn also has that official documentation page. You can go to that, you can search. So that's it for today. Those who have any doubts, you can ask. Rocking session, I don't know whether it's a rocking session or not. Again, I'll be coming on tomorrow afternoon with machine learning. Only with machine learning. I'll be talking about linear regression and logistic regression use case only. I'll be going a bit faster. Why? Because there is another session on clustering scheduled on tomorrow afternoon. So I'll be talking about this machine learning component only on tomorrow, right? And the day after tomorrow, I'll be talking about the deep learning part, the neural networks, whatever I know about neural networks. deep learning, convolution neural network, and a hands-on session in the app room. That's all assigned for me. Remaining sessions will be taken by other experts. Thank you for tolerating me for this much time. You know, I think I have done your assignments. At least you will give me 50% marks, right, for doing your assignments. Yeah. I don't know, 10 out of 10, right? Yeah. I'm learning only. But thanks a lot for your nice response. Nice to have a network with all the respected faculty members across India. Thank you so much. Is there anyone available? Biju sir, are you going to moderate or are you going to say goodbye or something? Are you available there?
Yeah. Hello. Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
I'm very much here.
Yeah, there is some sort of echo coming, but now I think it's okay.
Okay, so I guess everybody enjoyed their session.
Yeah, echo is there, ma'am. Ma'am, I think two devices are there. I think it is causing problem. Simultaneously, it's been logged in from two or multiple devices. That is a problem.
Hello.
Yeah, somebody wanted my details.
Hello.
Yeah, yes. Yes, ma'am. There is a lot of echo coming from there. Yeah, a lot of echo is there from that end.
Okay, we'll just check it around.
Fine, no problem, ma'am. I will share one more thing so that the participants ask me the yesterday's WhatsApp notebook. I will share it.
Okay, sir.
Yeah. The link I will be sharing it. This one, I think, yeah, this one.
Google Meet, I can
play. Now it's fine, I think, yeah.
Yeah, so just tell us when you finish sharing. You said you wanted to tell them something about yesterday.
Sure. I will share the PPT directly. PPT I will share it later. But still echo is coming, man, from there. I think since the mic is switched on, I think. That's the reason. Yeah. Mic is unmuted, I think the reason. It is not echo. It is not like earlier. Now it's fine. Now, let me share it with you. This code. It's already shared with this mail ID, but I know I will make it accessible to all.